We'll do just lay here. Would you lie with me and just forget the day? Hey everyone, it's Martin Tennant here. Here for another lesson for learning a new song. This time we're going to go for another classic song. It's Chasing Cars by Snow Patrol. One of my personal favourite songs of all time, especially from the 20 Knots. This song came out in 2006, and it's always been one of my favourite songs from when I was a teenager. It still is one of my favourite songs to this day because of the simplicity of it and the fact that it only is really based around three chords, and it focuses on layering the music rather as opposed to making it musically complicated. Simple, catchy melody, simple lyrics, and just an all-round great song to play with on the guitar. So what I'm going to do today, I'm going to break down this song for you. I'm going to show you how to play it somewhat similar to how it's done in the original track, but also altered slightly so that you could play this song with other people, you can jam with other people, or you can just play it yourself. So let's just get straight in. So the main riff of the song is pretty much just two notes. And we're going to rock back and forth between the two. Now what you want to do fretting wise, we're going to be up here on the 7th fret of the D string with the first finger, and we're in the key of A for this song, so that's your root A right there. And we're going to be playing E up here, which is on the 9th fret of the G string, okay? And the riff basically is go back and forth between A and E. You just keep on repeating that. That's all there is to it for the main riff. The main thing with this riff, I would say, is it's all about keeping it consistent and all the notes even, because some people have a problem to, they can play it well for a while and then after a while they start to lose momentum or agility or just the stamina starting to kick in their hand, starting to kill them, and they start to the notes just starts to not ring out. That sounded fine, as you could tell, but if you haven't practiced picking and building up your speed using a metronome, and if you find, you'll find that you'll get tired quite easily, the right hand will get tired, and you won't be able to keep up with the mentality of keeping that riff going nice and consistent all the way through. So if you find it hard to keep that riff going with all the notes evenly spaced between each other, no short notes or timing issues or issues with your hand, then you might have to want to consider spending a bit more time getting your timing in check and working on building your speed before you think of this in a song. Because as simple as it is, you do need to be able to have consistency in your ability to pick in the right hand in order to keep this riff and play it well. This song is more about consistency rather than ability. Anyway, back to the riff. So the riff is just those two notes. That's the first chord. And then when the licks start to come in, after the bit goes, we'll do it all, it then shifts to this chord here, which is a kind of an E chord, G sharp in the bass. And all we're doing here is we're going to keep our pinky opening the 9th fret exactly where it is. That's going to stay where it is, and the first finger is going to move down half a step down to the 6th fret. Okay, so now we have this E major with G sharp in the bass, and then you do the same movement with the picking hand. Okay, and then next, there's a bit of a stretch here. So you might, there's two ways you can do it. If this first one is too much for you, what you want to do is you want this from here. You want your first finger to stretch over down to the fifth fret of the D string, sorry, of the A string. I know that's quite a stretch. If you've got big hands like me, you should be able to do it. If your hands are too small, or if it's too much of a stretch for you, you're not used to that stretch, you can just do the open D string instead. And then you could use the, just keep the pinky where it is on the 9th fret. You just do open D. That'll work, but I think you probably will find that the tone on the open D is slightly different to how it is if you play it here on the 5th fret of A. Because that note there is being fretted, it produces a slightly different tone to the open D, as you can tell. Not that it really matters, it's whatever works best for you. But if you're able to, I would recommend you do it this way. It also kind of suits the kind of progression with your hand. With that type of movement, your hands and fingers will naturally want to do that kind of movement like that instead of, and because then you'll have an issue of where you put the first finger. But you can do it either way. The intro is pretty much just the A chord, right? And then when the verse comes in, you do A. Then you go to the E, then you go to the D, and back to the A, and then you do that again, and then after that we go into the chorus, and we're going to keep our fingers where they are up here in this A position that we've got here, and we're going to add the open A while picking the D and G, and we're going to mute out the other strings, low E and then the higher strings here, and we're going to just strum that, and it's give a down strumming, so it'll be like this. Right. After that, we've got this version, cool version of an E. Now you could either do it with 3 strings, or you can also do it 4 strings, include the low E in there. Either one will work. If you haven't got a bass player, you're probably better off doing the low E. If you have got a bass player playing with you, then you can just do the 3 strings. It really depends on your taste and what kind of musical situation you're in, really. So this shape here, what we've got here, we've got the first finger on this playing the G sharp on the 6th fret of the D, and then we've got the 2nd fret playing the 7th on the A string, and the pinky's still up here on the 9th fret of G, and if you want, you've got the open E as well. So that, okay, and then you do that for another 2 bars. And then we've got the D shape here. But this is basically, you can think of it as a D power chord. But we're going to be, instead of playing it with your 3rd finger, we're going to be playing this fret here with the 2nd finger. Again, might be a bit of a stretch, but you'll get it. So we have 1st finger on the 5th fret of A. Then we have 2nd finger on 7th fret of the D string. Then pinky's still up here on the 9th fret of G. So it's actually a D sus 2 chord. And you do that for two bars. And then go back to your E. Then we go back and do the same thing with the verse. Just go back to picking again. And if you want, you can do some open notes, so like the A or the E, to kind of add a bit more to the song. Like for instance, on the A, you could include the open A, so you'll do something like this. So what I did there, instead of playing the D string for the first note of the bar, I played the open A for the first note, then went up to the E, then did the rest with the on the D string. So it's... Then when you go to the E, you can include the low E string. So instead of doing... You go... You know, just the same idea, low E, then G string, D string, and so on. And with D, there isn't really anything you can do, you just play that the way it is. And so on. And then that goes on for the same length of time as you do with the verse 1. Verse 2 is the same length. You play the progression twice, then you go back to the chorus again and just do the same thing, but you put, because it's the second chorus is twice the length of the first chorus. So what's pretty cool about this song is that the chorus is longer every time you play it. First time it's 8 bars, second time it's 16 bars, and I think the last time is 32 bars or something like that. So it's longer every time. This kind of makes for a really interesting song progression and structure idea. So anyway, it's the same progression. You just you play the progression twice though, and you just do it the same way you did with the chorus one. Three is where the song tends to die down a little bit. There's sort of less going on in the song in terms of strumming or picking. So there's a couple of options for you here. There's actually no guitars really playing in that section at all. It's really a piano and drums and the bass that's really taking part in that section. But if you are playing this by yourself, there's a couple of things that you can do. You can just play all the chords, just play it, strum it once and then let it ring. Can do that, but you can add maybe the high strings as well to give it a bit more of a richer and fuller sound. You know, something like that. And then maybe halfway through you can start incorporating some picking ideas. You can go back to the main riff again. Or maybe you could go a bit further than that. Maybe you can do like strum up and down. Now all I'm doing there is I'm just picking all the notes down, starting on the fifth string, going to the fourth, three, two, one, then back up again, two, three, four, and then starting again. Maybe you want to do more of a palm muting idea. I'll do more of a rocky version, that maybe that could work. And then when we go into the last stretch of the song, the last chorus, this is where the song really sort of kicks in, and we got a bit of a rocky distortion going on. I'm just going to quickly turn on some distortion, like that. And basically all we're doing for this section is power chords. So we have A power chord, which is just a open A, 2nd fret D, 2nd fret G. And then we do that for 2 bars. Then we move over to E, which is open low E, 2nd on A, and 2nd on D. For 2 bars, then we go over to D, which is open D, 2nd on G, and 3rd on B. Again, 2 bars, and it's all down strums, by the way. These are all down strums, no up strumming at all, it's just all down. Then you go back to A. And if you want, when you go to the D, you can do a sus too, so you can include the open E string. Or even the full D chord if you want. If you want to be a bit more, even go even further than that, then you can do a D for the bar, then go to D sus 2, the second bar, for instance. So for that, just play a regular D and then just take the second finger off. For A, if you want, you can play the full A as well. If you want to have a bigger, greater harmony. Same for E. If you want to do E major, you can do the lower half of E. Get that major third in there. If you want, you can mix it up a bit. So maybe to begin with, you'll start off with just the power chords. And then the second time round, you play it with the full major chords. Sus chord, and then with that wee bit there, that sort of comes at the end of the 16th bar and the end of the 32nd bar, which is at the end of the chorus. So all I'm doing there is I'm taking the major chord, full major chord of A, and then just strumming it, and then strum it again, and pull off with this third finger, so you get the open B. And then strum again, and hammer on back to the second fret. After you've done that, the song ends with the final, it's the outro section where you just play in the original riff again. And then you just play the progression going from A to this version of E, then this D with the E on top, and back to A again. Towards the end there, you want to maybe slow down the riff just a little bit, just to kind of give it more of a dramatic ending to the song. And then you end on the ninth fret of G, and you just let it ring. It's Chasing Cars by Snow Patrol. I hope you enjoyed that. And there's more lessons to come where that came from. Stay tuned for that. Have fun with learning this song and playing this song. Add it to your repertoire of songs. Stay tuned for the next lesson in this series, and I'll see you next time.